All right, so we're like, what, 10 days into the new year. We've set those New Year's resolutions. Maybe we've kept some of them. Maybe we broke some of them really easily right off the bat. But we're in a series. This is week two of our series called Brand New. And it's not just a series called Brand New because we couldn't come up with a better name. It's really a series that we want all of us, each and every one of us, to take steps to become better and have a better view of who we are and who we want to be in 2022. Last week was a great message from Jeremy where we kind of kicked all of that off. If you haven't watched it, you can hop on over to our YouTube channel and you can rewatch that to catch up. I highly encourage you to do that if you haven't. But today we're going to be talking in part two of this series about something that we don't really hear a whole lot when we go to church, and that's desire, the word desire. And when we come to church, oftentimes we feel like we don't need to come desiring things that we want. We need to come to church to figure out what we need and the things that we need in our lives. And that's not always the case. And so today we're going to join Jeremy for part two of our series, Brand New, where we can talk about desire and understand that maybe we're looking at things a little bit differently. So why don't we join Jeremy?
Well, we're 2 weeks into our brand new series. And that's not because we're, you know, just crazy out of creative ideas. Like, we are talking about a brand new you. And I know if you're new to Journey Church, you've probably got some questions about the kinds of people who, you know, make up this place. If you are trying us out online, maybe before you show up in person and you kind of want to know what this place is like, I get it. I want you to know some stuff about this group of people. We're not a group of people that used to be people like you. And we're not a group of people that just tolerate or put up with people like you. And we're not a group of people who try to fix or change people like you. We're a group of people just like you. Now, I say that a lot, and I said it specifically today because I want to make sure that you understand something. We're going to talk about a few stories that are broken today, a few stories that are a mess. And I want to make sure you understand that we understand that I'm not talking about those people or that kind of people or broken, messed up people. I'm talking about us people. And we are the kind of people who all have parts of our story that we wish we could do over or change. There are parts I wish I could edit. There are parts of my story that I wish I could go back and delete, forget they ever like existed, right? Because that's kind of who we are. That's the reality of who we are as a church. But I want you to understand something. That this place, we say all the time, exists to help people take their next step toward Jesus. The better way to understand that maybe for today is this place exists to help you get past your past. That's what this whole brand new series is about. It's about branding yourself as completely new. A brand is a way of looking at yourself. And you understanding, and me understanding, that we are brand new matters to us. And so it's one more way that we work to get past our past. But to get past our past, or to take next steps, if you want to phrase it that way, we have to do something that doesn't feel very easy for us to do. We have to be honest and real about what we want, what we desire. What do you really desire? Now, to be honest with you, around church, that word desire is kind of not a common word. You know, it's not one that we use a lot, because the truth is it feels dangerous to desire, doesn't it? I mean, when we talk about what real desire talks about, we usually kind of lump that word in with things like sex, like people desire one another. That's a kind of dangerous sounding word, or people who really are the most well acquainted with wanting something so deeply are people that maybe have struggled through addiction. I know in my story and in the story of people I love, like, that idea is a strong one. And you have to recognize that there's something powerful about desire, because it's more than just, I kind of wanna, right? It's a desire, something that's deep inside of you. There was a guy that wrote a book called Into Thin Air, and it was about, the book is all about the ascent up Mount Everest. Mount Everest is a daunting, ridiculous task. And one of the things that he said was that the idea of climbing Mount Everest is ridiculous, right? It's completely antithetical to common sense. Everything about common sense would tell you that you should not even remotely bother getting up there. But the book is all about the ill-fated journey of a person named Yosoko. And Yosoko made the crested Mount Everest, or what is it called, summited Mount Everest. And she worked hard to it. It was a rough journey, lost a lot of people. In his book, he says that Yosoko was propelled up the mountain by the unwavering intensity of her desire. That's no joke. I mean, she wanted to move up that. Like he says that she was propelled or pushed up this mountain by this burning desire inside of her that overwhelmed even her common sense that would say that that's far too dangerous. There's always something in us that wants something more. Do you want something more out of your life? I mean, are you thinking that maybe part of the reason that you're even here today, maybe the reason that you chose to join us online and click and part of this is you're going, man, there's something more. Maybe you were just scrolling by in a news feed and you saw this and you were curious about it because there's some burning desire inside of you somewhere. Maybe it's small right now that is kind of asking, is this really all there is to life? And I want you to know that this is not all there is to life. There is more. And maybe the reason you're here today is to address that kind of bigger desire. And I want you to be propelled into a whole brand new life, basically propelled there by the overwhelming intensity of your desire. In fact, I would just say this, if you want more out of your life, you're gonna have to let that desire for more burn bigger in your life. There are a lot of people with wants and needs throughout Scripture. Now we're going to look at a few of these stories, and I got to be honest with you up front, we're not going to finish them, and I'll wait till the end to tell you how they end. But one of them happens in John chapter 5, and it's in the first five verses. It says, this is pretty crazy, it says this, afterward Jesus returned to Jerusalem for one of the Jewish holy days. Inside the city, near the sheep gate, was the pool of Bethesda with five covered porches. Crowds of sick people, blind, lame, or paralyzed, lay on the porches. And one of the men was lying there, had been sick for 38 years. And when Jesus saw him, he knew he had been ill for a long time, and he asked him, what would you like to get well? Now listen, I gotta be honest with you. When I see this verse, like when I hear this story, you just gotta kind of imagine it. There's this pool, and there are these covered porches that are nearby, and there are tons of sick and blind and lame people and people who are outcast and poor and everything else. Why are they there? There was this rumor that had kind of gone around, or at least this understanding, that if you were there at this place, then all of a sudden at some point this angel could show up and stir the waters up. And if you were the first one in the waters, you would be healed. Now, I don't know the veracity. I don't know the truth of the claim. I don't know, did it really happen, or was it something that just had been a rumor? But I do know this, that messed up people, people who are broken and looking for something more, willing to be honest about this desire, they'll hold on to anything. And I don't know what happened. And they didn't know what happened. I mean, the truth of it is, even the rumor said, like, they didn't know exactly when it happened. So they'd have to show up every single day just in hopes that today was the lottery day. That's what this man had been doing. for 38 years, he'd been getting somebody to carry him down there because he was lame, couldn't walk, right? Lame, boring. But he was lame, couldn't walk. And so somebody would carry him, a friend, a family member, somebody would haul him down there and drop him off. Now, I don't know how he anticipated getting into the water, but that was another issue. So he'd been coming there for 38 years and hadn't seen anything. This angel hadn't showed up. I don't know about you, but I'd be pretty disenfranchised. Maybe that's kind of how you feel today. Maybe you show up at church all the time, or maybe you're part of it and you're a little disenfranchised because something hasn't really ever just miraculously happened. Do you ever get frustrated like that? I do. I get frustrated because sometimes I want something to happen, or at least I think I really want it, but I kind of want it, you know? And something doesn't happen the way I want it to. I want like a miraculous thing to show up. And all of a sudden, I realize maybe it doesn't. Here's the question this guy's at. 38 years he's been sick. 38 years he hasn't been able to walk. 38 years he's been having somebody drag him down to this place over and over and over again in hopes that the miraculous angel would show up and stir up the waters and he'd be healed. But the angels never showed up. And the angels never stirred the waters. And he's never been healed. And he's a little bummed about that. And then comes Jesus. What's crazy about it in the last couple of verses, Jesus saw him and he knew that he'd been ill for a long time. And he still asked this question, would you like to get well? Doesn't that seem like a callous sort of question? I mean, it does to me. It seems like kind of a ridiculous question. Of course I want to get well. It's ridiculous. That's really the question that you and I have to ask, is the same question he was asking this man. He wasn't being calloused. He knew this man's heart. He knew what was really going on. He knew that he was showing all that, but he wanted to hear it from him. Are you aware of your desire? Do you want to get well? That's the real question he was asking that man laying there by the pool, is why are you here? It's the question that I want to ask you. Why are you here? I mean, you just show up today because, you know, you're here out of obligation, you know? People do that all the time. It's called religion, right? People show up and think, man, I'm supposed to be at church. I'm supposed to go to church, you know, once or twice or three times a month or a couple times a year. Or maybe you're here because it's a brand new year and you're going, man, kind of just want a fresh start, trying something new. But the question is, why are you here? Are you here because you don't want to miss part of this series and you want to come back next week and the relationships, you want to be able to talk about what happened last week? You don't want to feel like an outsider? Why are you here? Are you here because you're going through some sort of motion or trying to fill some sort of need? Or are you, kind of like what Jesus was asking this man, are you in check with, are you aware of your real desire? What's the real motivation for you moving forward? Why don't you invest this hour? Ask that question today. Why are you here? We're going to jump to another story. I'll come back to the man a little bit later. This next story is in Matthew chapter 20. It starts in like verse 29. And it's a story of Jesus walking down this road and this crowd that was making a lot of noise and a couple of blind men had wanted Jesus' attention. It says this, as Jesus and then the disciples left the town of Jericho and the large crowd followed behind them, two blind men were sitting beside the road. When they heard that Jesus was coming that way, they began shouting, Lord, Son of David, have mercy on us. The crowd wasn't happy about that, so they said this in verse 31. Be quiet, the crowd yelled at them. But they only shouted louder. Lord, Son of David, have mercy on us. When Jesus heard them, he stopped and called, what do you want me to do for you? Well, we talked about the man who was at the pool at Bethesda, and why did he show up there? Jesus asking him, and he seems like he has a pattern of asking these somewhat calloused sounding questions, doesn't he? I mean, it's two blind men who are getting yelled at by the crowd for wanting something. They were aware of their desire that had awakened in them. They were fully aware, in fact, and they wouldn't take no for an answer. The crowd tells them to be quiet, and they shouted all the more valuable, all the more loudly, all the more obtrusively, Lord, Son of David, have mercy on us. And Jesus asked them this question, what do you want me to do for you? What I love about these guys isn't just that they recognized Jesus could heal them, right? They were blind and they realized Jesus had power. They were in check. They were well aware of their greatest desire. So much so that Jesus asked them that question just to bring it out of them. I want you to recognize another thing, that the crowd doesn't like people who are aware of what they want. You know this, right? You know that when you've moved forward and you're going, I want to do this with my career, or I want to do that with my life, or I want to pursue this kind of marriage, that the people around you don't like that. Why is that? Because most of the time, the people around you are not in check, not aware of their desire. The crowd will fight you when you're aware of what you want, because this is what is at the crux of this whole message of faith. Are you wanting something specific? I mean, we ask this question, why are you here today? Another question you'll ask is, what do you want from Jesus? They ask these men on the side of the road, what do you really want from me? Just so that he could make sure that their desire and their awareness were in sync. What do you want from Jesus? I mean, are you really showing up here because you want something specific? It's one of the problems we have with Christianity today is that we've reduced Christianity, the whole idea of Christianity, down to some sort of moral development equation. If you do this and you do this, you'll be a better person. Or some kind of gospel of sin management. If you do this and do this, you'll be able to keep your addiction, your anger, your whatever under control. How's that going for you? I don't know anybody it's worked for, right? I don't know anybody who's become a better person by putting A and B together. And I don't know anybody who's been able to effectively manage their sin, because that isn't how it works. I love how John Eldridge puts this. He says this, at the core, Christianity begins with an invitation to desire. At the core, Christianity is really an invitation for you to begin to desire. Why are you here, man who's laying by the pool? What do you want from me, blind person on the side of the road? What can I do for you? The same questions he's asking us. What do we want out of this whole relationship with Jesus, this whole brand new thing? What do you really want to see happen in your life? The next step I'd offer you today, the thing that I really think you and I should center our questions on, is answering some of those questions. What do we really want? We just want a better life, or we just want to feel better on Tuesday about having not skipped out on church on Sunday? I mean, what do we really want? What do you really want? There's one more verse, or one more story that I want to kind of bring up to us. And it happens in John chapter 4, and it starts in verse 7. It's a fairly well-known story, and it says this. Soon a Samaritan woman came to draw water, and Jesus said to her, please, give me a drink. He was alone at the time because the disciples had gone into the village to buy some food, and the woman was surprised. For Jews refused to do anything, have anything to do with Samaritans. And she said, Jesus, you are a Jew, and I'm a Samaritan woman. Why are you asking me for a drink? It's a common story. Maybe you've heard it before, the story of this Samaritan woman who had a reputation. She was coming to get water in the middle of the day instead of in the morning when it was cool and reasonable out and when all the other women would come down there. She was just trying to survive. You see, back then, especially, that the idea of having multiple partners in your life was not at all allowed. Not at all tolerated, not at all looked up to. And today we tolerate it a bit more, but then it was terrible. And coupled on top of that, not only was she a woman with a reputation, she was a Samaritan woman with a reputation. It was bad. It was bad for her. In fact, she could only go to the well in the afternoon when nobody else was going, because she wouldn't have to deal with all the perceptions, all the whispering, all the disdain that she'd experienced from other people. So she was there and Jesus was there. I think Jesus was there because she was going to be there. And Jesus asked her for a drink. He said, would you give me something to drink? And what she answered was, how can you ask me to do that? And what Jesus' reply was right after that, he says, if you only knew the gift of God, the God that has for you, you would be, and who is speaking to you, you would ask me and I would give you living water. Now listen, here's the thing. He was well aware that she was aware of her desire. I mean, her desire to survive was really the biggest one. Sometimes we'll have a tendency to fault this lady and like, you know, say things that make it sound like she chose this lifestyle. But for her and her culture and the world that she lived in, if she didn't have a husband, she didn't have a way to live. Women weren't valued, weren't significant. And the only significance they had was really in their relationship with a man. And the man had all the power in the relationship. He could get rid of this relationship for any reason he wanted. He could just decide, I don't need you anymore, and kick her out. And she would be out on her own and with nothing to do, nothing, no way to provide for herself. So she had systematically latched herself on to whomever would take her in. One man after another. The Bible says total of six different lovers. Six different men who used her for what she was worth to them and provided some kind of moderate ways of living for them. She was stuck in a world of maintaining. One relationship after another just to provide for what she needed to stay alive. One trip to the well in the afternoon for what she needed to be able to make it through the day. Here's the thing that Jesus was well aware of. He knew, and we don't, all of the circumstances of what brought her to these terrible places where she had to listen and lean into whatever this next man wanted from her to make things better for her. She was stuck in a world of maintaining. When Jesus said, would you give me something to drink? When Jesus broke down the barriers between the person who was at the well in the afternoon and this lady who was a Samaritan woman and he's a Jew, he broke down racial and moral barriers so that he could help her come to full realization that what she was doing was just trying to maintain from day to day. And Jesus was saying, I want to give you life and give it to the full. I would give you this living water and you would never be able to never be thirsty again. And that's really kind of the crux of the deal for her. I mean, Jesus was asking her a really important question, kind of the same thing that he'd be asking you and me today, right? What is it that you're searching for in your maintenance? Like, she's maintaining and she's just searching for a way to survive, right? She's showing up at the well at the afternoon to get some water. She's staying with this next man because he provides a shelter for her and some kind of pathway to exist. And she was maintaining, doing everything she could. But you and I are maintaining too, right? We're trying to hold our sin underneath the water. It's like a beach ball. And we keep pushing the beach ball down. We keep maintaining it. What are we searching for when we're doing that? I'm searching for freedom from it. Right? What are you searching for when you're maintaining that addiction? You're going, man, I just got to get through today. What are you trying to do? You're trying to survive? Are you trying to eke out some kind of life? That's really the question that you and I have to ask. We're all maintaining something. We're all just kind of eking through a marriage problem or eking through a financial issue. We're doing what we can to maintain it and keep it under control. But what do you really want from that? Why are you really here? What do you really want from Jesus? Inside of your maintenance, what are you really searching for? You're really searching for freedom? You're really searching for healing? Are you really wanting something? And if you don't connect the dots between what you really want in your maintenance and bringing that to the front and letting it propel you up the mountain like Yasuko, propel you up the mountain by the unwavering intensity of your desire, if you don't ever come face to face with what you want, then you'll never be able to see what you want happen. It's important for us to understand that. I love the stories of the Chronicles of Narnia. I don't know if you're familiar with either the books or the movies, but in the movie, The Chronicle of Narnia, the Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, there was a character named Tumnus, who's a particularly kind of aware character. And he and someone else are talking, and they're talking about this character, Aslan. Aslan is the Christ figure. He's this giant lion that is seen as a part of this whole story. And the character asks Tumnus and says, is Aslan safe? And he looks up at Aslan and he says, no, he is not safe, but he is good. That's the thing that you and I have to understand. I think when we talk about our desire, And Jesus' invitation to ask us, what do we really want? Why are you really here? What do you really want from Jesus? What are you really searching for? What is the unwavering intensity that's sleeping inside of you that needs to awaken? When we begin to ask that question, we have to ask this one. Can I trust Jesus with my desire? Is it safe? No, it's not safe, but it is good. It's not safe for us to do those things because we have to risk disappointment, don't we? If we're honest about our desire for healing, we have to risk the potential that we don't get what we want when we want it. If we have to really be honest about our desire for freedom from that sin, that anger, that addiction, right? We have to be honest with ourselves about the desire. We have to risk that the healing doesn't come when I want it to, or in the way I want it to, or with the amount of work I want it to. What if we are honest about our desire for something? What if we awaken that desire inside of us, and then we go, oh man, that's an awful lot more work than I thought it was gonna be. Kind of how Yusuko felt, I'm sure, looking at Mount Everest. There are probably times halfway up the mountain where she said, I can't do it. But she was propelled up the mountain by the unwavering intensity of her desire. Are you gonna be aware of your desire? I think that, like what Jesus was saying to this woman at the well, if you only knew the gift of God that God has for you and who you're speaking to, you would ask me and I would give you living water. I think the thing that I want us to recognize kind of as we wrap this up, if you knew how good God was, if you knew how good Jesus was, then you would beg for what he's offering. He's offering freedom. He's offering this potential in your life to be not only free from the power of sin, but working toward and growing in this relationship that gives you freedom from the presence of it. If you only knew how good Jesus was, I know that you'd be begging for what he's offering. So maybe that's where you need to land today. Maybe you need to begin to lean into how good Jesus is. He wants freedom for you. He wants healing for you. He wants a brand new life. Let's find out what he wants for us.